Welcome to Morgantown and welcome to the Gold Rush. Milan Pushkar Stadium is sold out today. 60,000 strong have waited a long time for this one. West Virginia and number 15 Virginia Tech is coming up today at FS1 as a rivalry is renewed. And good afternoon, everybody. It is so great to have you with us alongside Devin Gardner. I'm Corey Provis. This is going to be a lot of fun, Devin, as we look forward to this one today. First for West Virginia, redshirt senior quarterback Jared Dagey gets his first taste of this rivalry today.
Yeah, and he's excited about it. He's a quarterback I really like, Corey. He has a big arm. He can create in and out of the pocket, and he has a competitive fire. Now, that competitive fire can sometimes get him in trouble, especially on the road. Take a look at his record and his play when he's home and away. It's a vastly different quarterback, and he needs to be that home quarterback coming into this game and avoid the big mistake and maybe try to curve that competitive fire a bit.
Yeah, Dagey had two picks in the week one loss against Maryland. West Virginia just crushed LIU last week, but a much stiffer challenge today against a Virginia Tech defense, very stout, that is allowing only 12 points per game after two games.
This is a rambunctious bunch of defenders, and what they do best, they get after the quarterback, and they get after him often. How much do we get after him, Corey? Well, they are ninth in the FBS in quarterback sacks, but even more important than those sacks, they take the ball away. Jermaine Waller has two interceptions in as many games, and he's looking for the trifecta this afternoon.
Well, center Brock Hoffman, he got the Hokies fired up earlier, understandably so, a leader on his Tech team. West Virginia, they've waited a long time for the Hokies to come back to Morgantown. In fact, the last time that these two teams met was 2005. The Mountaineers last won this matchup in 2003. And here come the Mountaineers. Over the years, and hopefully we will build on that today. The 53rd all-time meeting between Virginia Tech and West Virginia. They have been playing for the Black Diamond Trophy since 1997. The Hokies have won the last three. They last met in a neutral site game in Maryland at FedEx Field back in 2017. Justin Fuente in his sixth year at Virginia Tech, looking to lead the Hokies their first 3-0 start since 2017. On the other side, Neil Brown has a matchup today against a ranked team. So far in two-plus seasons, he has one win over against a ranked team. That was against Kansas State last season. He's 1-7 in those top 25 matchups. It is a gorgeous day in Morgantown. Bright and sunny, 79 degrees and light winds at Milan Pushkar Stadium. West Virginia won the toss, deferred, so the Hokies will get the ball first. Raheem Blackshear back to receive. Keyshawn King is out today with a non-COVID-related illness. Sit back and enjoy. Tech in West Virginia underway from Morgantown. And no return for Blackshear. So Virginia Tech will start from its own 25-yard line. Braxton Burmeister is the redshirt junior quarterback from La Jolla, California. He is 5-1 as a starting quarterback, Devin, at Virginia Tech. And this will be the most hostile road environment since he was an Oregon Duck when he played in front of about 70,000 against Washington in 2017.
Yeah, that Gold Rush is alive this afternoon, and he's looking to stay away from mistakes and make sure that he gets this offense rolling to start.
And will Virginia Tech force it a bit more down the field? Burmeister sets it up. This is Blackshear with a hole. Blackshear across the 40-yard line. Tackled by Daryl Porter Jr., but a good play and first down for the Hokies. A 20-yard gain on first down. Turner in motion. Here's Turner. Stretched out well by Alonzo Adai. And the West Virginia defense, no gain. Blackshear the tailback on second down and long as Blackshear up the middle stood up near midfield, maybe a gain of 4 or 5. Tackled by Josh Chandler Cimito, the Mountaineers' leading tackler. The Virginia Tech offense, the starters today, the offensive line. And you see the center, Brock Hoffman, co-captain.
Burmeister's leg is going to come into play big here on third down to start the game.
It is loud in Morgantown on 3rd and 5. Burmeister pressured and down he goes. Taj Alston with the pressure. And it's 4th down.
You can see Burmeister's going to drop back and he doesn't see anyone open. Coach Neil Brown said they're going to make sure that they don't play a bunch of men. They're going to keep their eyes on the quarterback, and they had everyone covered, every zone matched, and he had nowhere to go with the ball.
The punter is Pete Moore, a freshman with a big leg, and this one will land in the end zone and come out to the 20-yard line. So a 50-yard punt. And now we'll see West Virginia on offense for the first time, and redshirt senior Jared Dagey, 6-0. Devin, you touched on that during the open here at home.
Yeah, he's really good at home. He struggled on the road, but lucky for him in West Virginia, he is at home with the crowd behind him. Look for him to make some big throws.
25 touchdowns, 9 interceptions, and 15 starts. Lenny Brown, the tailback. Movement at the line. Dagey looking deep. First play down the sideline. Incomplete, looking for Sam James. No flag.
No flag on the play, and he had him on this route, just a go route. He's going to give vertical, a stutter, and go. Oh, my goodness. That's how you start a football game, right? Let him know we will try to take the top off on this man defense. Virginia Tech loves man. 30 snaps of man defense against North Carolina 2 weeks ago, and they are comfortable staying in it. Look for West Virginia to continue to attack in that way.
And James made an ankle-breaking move on Armani Chapman, the cornerback. Here's Lenny Brown up the middle with a big hole. Lenny Brown right up the gut. Inside the 10. Touchdown, West Virginia. Second play from scrimmage. Brown goes for 80 and to the house.
Talk about parting like the Red Sea. You start a football game.
19th career rushing score for Brown, is 24th overall in his West Virginia career, and the extra point from Casey Legg is good. What a start for West Virginia. Lenny Brown, 80 yards to the house. 7-0 Mountaineers. Don't back down, just don't back down. Football is sponsored by Edward Jones. Life is for living. Let's partner for all of it. Hopefully the West Virginia fans did not wait too long to work their way inside Pushkar Stadium, because they would have missed an 80-yard touchdown run from Letty Brown on the second play from scrimmage for the Mountaineers today. Staley the boot, and no return from Blackshear. Let's go back to the 80-yard run a moment ago, Devin.
Yeah, the reason this works so well, you have five offensive linemen that can block. One, two, three, four, and five. The one person they cannot block is right here, Dax Hollifield. Now, the reason he's not going to be able to make the play, the tight end moves out, and he has to go with him, and it clears a lane for Letty Brown to get right down the middle of the field for a touchdown.
That's a great block there from the center, Zach Frazier.
You move the one unblocked defender, the one guy you can't account for. You get him outside of the box, and now you have a plan, and Letty Brown can go hit his head on the goalpost.
Jalen Holston, the tailback, his first series. It'll be Burmeister pressured, steps up, and he's sacked. There's Alonzo Adai, another good play early in this first quarter.
Virginia Tech has it this year. Found the ability to drive the ball down the field. So you can see that these defenders are flying to the ball. Alonzo Adai stays near the line of scrimmage for that very reason. He is fast and he can get to the ball as quickly as he can. Coach talked about how smart he is, talking about he's one of the more talented defenders, but his brain is what helps him make a lot of plays. You can see that brain working right there.
Now, Burmeister statistically is the fastest player on this Virginia Tech team. But could not escape a die there after a loss of five. Now we'll dump it off. This is Holston. He is upended. Back at the 19-yard line by Darryl Porter Jr. No gain on the play. Luke Tenuta, the left tackle, goes from right to left tackle. Christian Darrisaw drafted by the Vikings in the first round. Now the tight end, Drake Julius, starts today. Virginia Tech without a key guy the rest of the season. Co-captain James Mitchell out for the year with a knee injury. On third and long, Alston brings pressure. They set up the screen for Holston. Can he get outside? No. Well contained by the Mountaineers, who are flying to the ball. Lance Dixon with the tackle.
The transfer from Penn State came to play. You could see him from the start of the play. He is one of the fastest linebackers on this team, and he flies and shuts that screen down from the start. When it's third and 15, there aren't a ton of plays in the playbook, right? Especially when you're a team that doesn't necessarily drive the ball down the field. They get to a third and 15, they have to stay out of that type of down and distance.
West Virginia brought pressure. And a return from Esdale. And he steps out near the 45-yard line. It's a 41-yard punt, a return of seven. So West Virginia will have great field position when we come back. The offense with a big play. The defense stepping up early, 7-0 Mountaineers. Team goals are sponsored by Edward Jones. Life is for living. Let's partner for all of it.
For Virginia Tech, on offense, they need to get the ball down the field. They're going to have to take some shots to loosen up this West Virginia defense. And they also need to make sure that they deal with the atmosphere. You can see this is a rambunctious crowd, and they have to deal with it.
Letty Brown is second carry. Goes for about four. Tackled by Alan Tisdale and Jermaine Waller.
For West Virginia, their defense wants to make sure they get Burmeister going left and right. East and west is going to be conducive for them, and Jarrett Dagey has to protect the ball.
So the Mountaineers starting offensive line, Doug Nestor, right guard, transfer from Virginia Tech. West Virginia native. On second down and six, Dagey throws, that's caught. First down across the 45-yard line by Esdale. His fifth catch of the season, but a flag on the field. This is an ACC officiating crew today. And a referee is Riley Johnson.
Personal foul, hands to the face. Defense number 45. 15-yard penalty and an automatic first down.
You know, Devin, that is just the sixth.
Helmet does not have to leave the game for one play.
That is just the sixth penalty on Virginia Tech all season long. So two games, two wins, both at home, but now on the road for the first time.
You can see right here, fighting for his life there, and he's going to push the offensive guy's helmet right off his head. You see, he knew right away. He jogged off the field, but then when the penalty is against the defense, you can come back on.
So Brandon Yates, left tackle, stays in.
Virginia Tech is staying in this man-to-man defense. I wouldn't be surprised if they take a shot here. Free play.
On first down, and Daigie will take a shot towards the end zone. It's caught! Touchdown! Bryce Ford Wheaton! The redshirt junior got behind two Virginia Tech defenders, and Daigie let his receiver make a play.
Throwing the deep ball is so important to get the ball up high so your player sees it first. His receiver sees it first. He can make a play on it, and it's a touchdown for Bryce Ford Wheaton. And you got a free play. Throw it up. Give your guy a chance, and he makes good on his promise and makes the catch.
His first touchdown reception this season, sixth of his career. So West Virginia, big play on the ground, big play in the air. An incredible start for the Mountaineers. Bryce Ford Wheaton, 29-yard touchdown reception. Daigie, the Mountaineers, having on the excellent field position and a penalty. Three plays, 55 yards. Daigie to Bryce Ford Wheaton, a 29-yard touchdown pass. 14-0 Mountaineers. Staley's kick. Blackshear watches this one go into the end zone. Now West Virginia's had the ball twice and two quick scores. The second play from scrimmage, Letty Brown, 80-yard run up the gut.
This West Virginia offense is batting 1,000 so far. They're doing everything they wanted to do. They wanted to get Letty Brown going. And what did they want to do with their quarterback? Put it in the air and let their talented receivers make plays. I'm not a fool and I'm not a scientist, Corey, but I can just guarantee that Coach Fuente, if he had a scenario of how he didn't want the game to start, this is exactly what it looked like.
Here's a toss to Blackshear, looking for a block to the outside. Blackshear, nice run across the 30-yard line. A gain of five, run out by Jackie Matthews as we look at the Mountaineer defense. Boy, Dante Stills, his family, they have some history with this rivalry against Virginia Tech. Lance Dixon has made a couple of big plays early. Nick Troy Fortune, Jordan Leslie, the D coordinator, believes he is the Mountaineers' best cover corner in the secondary. Now whistle blows it dead.
Ball starts. Offense number 76. 5-yard penalty. Second out.
That's the co-captain center, Brock Hoffman, the second Virginia Tech penalty.
Yeah, it looks like that crowd is really getting involved in this game. Just a little flinch by the center there, and that's their leader, right? That's their guy that they lean on when things are going bad, and he creates a penalty right there.
Hoffman
already
today.
Two penalties.
Yeah, Hoffman today is 38th career start. Negates the first down run. Burmeister to the outside, and he takes a shoulder, and a flag comes down, and Daryl Porter Jr. is going to be flagged for a late hit on Burmeister.
After the player was out of bounds, personal foul, late hit, defense number two, 15-yard penalty, and an automatic first down.
Former quarterback here.
Yeah, it's a bang, bang play, Corey. And I am a former quarterback, and I love protection. But he's not out of bounds just yet. That's a missed call there by the referees. Remember, Coach Fuente talked about Burmeister not taking those shots, right? Get out of bounds a little more quickly so that you don't have to take those shots and be okay to play the rest of the game.
So it's a first down as the ball moves across the 40-yard line. Five receivers set. Burmeister unloads to Blackshear. He is tackled back behind the 40-yard line by Sean Mahone. The second leading tackler on this Mountaineer defense makes a play.
We talked about it during the team goals. You've got to get the ball down the field. West Virginia is going to sit back in their zone defense and let everything play out in front of them and then sprint to the ball just like you saw there.
And Burmeister has some good speed options. Haven't called Trey Turner's name yet today. Tavion Robinson.
Yes. The usual suspects when the Virginia Tech offense has success.
So after the penalty, Virginia Tech goes backwards. On second and 14, over the middle, that's caught by Caleb Smith, who has the honor of wearing number 25 today. Great tradition that Justin Fuente started his first year honoring the great Frank Beamer, who wore that number during his career. It's handed out to a player who must also be on special teams, and Caleb Smith is just the fifth wide receiver to ever wear number 25, and the first since Trey Turner did so back in 2018.
Speed option would be great down here.
Third and short, pressure coming. Nice catch by Blackshear. Can he get around? He does. Needs a block, and he'll pick up the first down. Gain of six for the Rutgers transfer. Raheem Blackshear, his second year as a Hokie.
West Virginia did not expect the screen on third and very, very short. Burmeister does a great job of drawing the defense in. Bring him in, and dump it right over his head. Raheem Blackshear is the pass catcher of the running back group.
Now Burmeister, six completions so far, five to running backs so far today. Blackshear comes out, Holston back in. It's Holston trying to cut back, not happening. Deshaun Stevens, linebacker from Toronto, made the tackle. There is a flag.
Illegal substitution, 12 men on defense, 5-yard penalty, still first down.
You run that outside zone play, you wonder, why can't we get in the yard? Well, the defense has 12 players on the field, so that's why it makes it a little easier to stop the running game of Virginia Tech. Burmeister's looking a lot more comfortable, right, in a groove. Like you said, he's only committed plays to running backs. Can he get the ball down the field is the question.
First time the Hokies have the ball inside West Virginia territory, and Holston meets helmet to helmet with Sean Mahone. Boy, Jalen Holston, Justin Fuente told us last night, believes that he is the Hokies' best all-around back.
Yeah, they say he's got great size, right? 5'11", 215 pounds. That's a man. I mean, I chose to play quarterback because of guys like this. I do not want to have to get caught in a situation where I have to meet that man in the hole.
Holston was actually on the Tech roster when these two teams last met in 2017. Blackshear back in. Blackshear up the middle, and he is gobbled up by Dante Stills along with Jordan Jefferson. No gain in the play. Turner in motion. Turner trying to get the edge and ducks under inside the 35 and then is driven back. And there is Alonzo Adai again. Boy, is the redshirt senior number four all over the place in this first quarter. So third down and eight. Perhaps four down territory here for Virginia Tech. Pressure coming. Good time for Burmeister. Throws. Tight window. That's caught by Smith. And he'll have the first down pending the flag. Second reception for Smith. For now, a gain of 8. There's a big call upcoming here.
If this stands, that's exactly what Coach Fuente is looking for from his quarterback. Drop back, stand in the pocket, and then deliver a comeback to the outside.
Defense number 2. That's an automatic first down.
So Virginia Tech, by far its best drive so far today, as Porter flagged for the call.
Right, I mean, you run a comeback, and at the top of the route, he's going to grab and try to get a little too handsy. That's a great throw, though. I mean, the game of inches. He puts that ball exactly where it has to be caught. Now, he gets the pass interference, but had he not gotten that, it's still a first down. Very nice job by Burmeister continuing to be more comfortable in this game, down 14.
Inside the 25-yard line, it's a run up the middle for Holston, and he picks up about 2 yards. Scotty Young Jr., transfer from Arizona, made the tackle. And there's an injured Hokie on the field. That is Silas Janzy, starting right tackle. So we'll step aside. Here the is out of this game. Could not put any weight on his right leg as he needed help coming off the field. So Tyrell Smith comes in his spot at right tackle. You see the numbers, Devin, so far for Braxton Burmeister today.
Yeah, we talked to him last night. He said, I'm here to be efficient, right? I want to protect the ball, and he's doing a great job of that right now. And you can see he's not being safe, right? He's being perfect after you saw that last throw on third down.
Thanks to toss. Burmeister towards the end zone, going up and catching. Touchdown, Virginia Tech. Tavion Robinson, 23 yards. And the Hokies answer here late first quarter.
Right here, he's going to get down the middle of the field and make a play for his quarterback. When you get up on safety linebacker types, you have an advantage. And if you, the ball, like I said earlier, if the ball is high and your receiver sees it first, he can make a play on it. The DB's playing DB for a reason, right? He just doesn't even know where the ball is.
Had a touchdown last week against Middle Tennessee State. So Burmeister and the Hokies answer back, capitalizing on 3 West Virginia penalties, and this is now a 1-score game.
7 of 7, 58 yards, and that beautiful touchdown pass right there. Burmeister came to play. Like I was talking about just before the play, he said he wants to be efficient, right? He's not going to feel the pressure of having to throw the ball if it's not there. He's found open guys. He's made the throws. He's checked it down. He's done everything he needs to do in the game so far.
And credit the offensive line on that drive. When he did throw, he had time. That wasn't happening on their earlier drives.
Yeah, time is very important, right? And remember, he talked about he's still developing as a quarterback, finding a way to feel comfortable taking those chances, taking those shots, feeling comfortable with his wide receivers. You can see right there, he feels comfortable.
And now we'll see, as the Hokies kick it off, will they challenge the dangerous Winston Wright Jr., who took the opening kickoff back for a touchdown last week against Long Island. Wright is averaging 51 yards per return, number 1 nationally.
He's explosive. I talked to the coach. He said, hey, his near version of Tavion Austin, maybe not quite Tavion Austin, right, because we know how amazing he was, but he's a close second, if you ask me.
Right. Here he comes. Right. 20-yard line. And knocked out near the 25. A rivalry renewed today. And what a rivalry it has been over the years and decades. Then that annually Southern Conference Big East Days, 73 up to 2005. Michael Vick, Shane Graham, the miracle in Morgantown in 1999. West Virginia's last win against Virginia Tech was a blowout back in 2003.
Coach Rick Rodriguez was the coach then, and I talked to his wife, Rita Rodriguez, and she remembered vividly Travis Garvin catching a short pass over the middle on third down and taking it 93 yards for a touchdown. He and she both talked about the atmosphere. It was insane for them. They just couldn't, they'd never seen Morgantown so excited. And Coach Rod said he had to come out and tell the students over the PA to go home because they stormed the field and they thought they were going to spend the night because the game, it was just electric.
Now West Virginia will get the ball for the third time. So far, two drives, only five plays.
Seems relatively productive.
There was a penalty on the return, so it's pushed back to the 10-yard line. And a first down run for Letty Brown. Some pushing and shoving to be expected after the play, but no flag. Now, as for this Hokie defense, it has been a rough go so far for the Hokie defense.
I mean, it's so rough, we couldn't even get to the lineups, right? These drives are so fast, we can't even show you who's playing on that Hokie defense. But they have some talented young men out there.
Now, Garrett Green has come in now at quarterback for West Virginia, his second game. Redshirt freshman from Tallahassee.
He loves read option, draw opportunities.
And he'll tuck it and run. And he'll have the first down. Now, Garrett Green, a guy that Neil Brown recruited when Brown and his staff were still at Troy, an accomplished baseball player growing up. He was not allowed to play football until the seventh grade. His dad, Charlie, played in the big leagues for 5 years as a catcher. And Charlie still works for the Milwaukee Brewers now. Heard a lot about Garrett Green this week. His toughness won in high school. He stole home for a walk-off win. Stole home to win a high school baseball game. Play clock late. Daigie back in. He'll throw. Tipped in. Incomplete. Now, Jamari Connor was in the vicinity of that pass intended for Winston Wright Jr.
Linebacker Dax Hollifield was right there just to get a nick of the ball, just barely tipped it and changed the direction.
See the numbers on Daigie so far, 36 yards with a touchdown. They like Brown in the passing game, but instead, underneath, it's caught across the 25-yard line. That's Sean Ryan with his seventh reception this season, tackled by Jermaine Waller. There's a big third and five upcoming.
That concept with the outside receiver coming in, sitting down in the zone with a corner from the slot and a swing from the running back. We called that Trojan when I was in college, and it's their favorite concept to try to get the ball and get 5 to 6 yards on medium situations.
This is the Mountaineers' first third down today. Hokies bring three. Incomplete. Intended for Ford Wheaton. As Daigie was hit, and for the first time today, the Hokies defense makes a stand.
You can see they try to have a mesh concept or shallow cross concept with to the field. The quarterback has an option to throw the comeback if he likes it. He wanted to get to the comeback because the shallow cross was taking a little too long, had some pressure, threw the ball away.
Now, Tyler Sumter will punt, something he did not do one time last week in a 66-0 win against Long Island. Robinson spins away once, not twice. 38-yard punt, no return. And the Hokies will get the ball back down seven. Keep it right here on FS1 because coming up next, Chris Olave and ninth-ranked Ohio State look to get back on track as they host the Tulsa Golden Hurricane. College football action rolls on next on FS1.
I would not be a team going into Columbus after a loss where the Ducks left a little duck in the middle of the field. I would not want to be that team.
That's Trey Turner coming out. And that is worth watching, a vital part of the Hokie offense. Junior wide receiver. From the 36. Burmeister rolls again time. This is where he's dangerous. Great speed. Burmeister runs out of bounds across the 40-yard line. 8-5.
Corey, watching him drop back and read the defense and then take off that way, I can't help. I see Taylor Martinez, and if you remember Taylor Martinez, he played for Nebraska in the years that I was playing, and I gotta announce how, you know, long ago that was, but it looks just like him, right, where he takes off and he's so fluid as a runner and he feels just so comfortable.
Now Burmeister throws, and that looked like a busted play. He was looking right, looking left, then incomplete.
Corey, that's not a busted play. That's the new iteration of the play action pass, but from quarterback run, right? He fakes the quarterback power right down the middle, but he's peeking up just to see, do you commit? And then he throws a little jump pass, right? That jump pass comes from Tim Tebow.
Right.
But that fake quarterback run, I remember Denard Robinson doing that all the time, and defenses could not stop it.
So could not connect with Blackshear.
Man, football has really developed, right? Play action without faking it to a running back, right? Because you're such a talented runner. I love it.
Mountaineers showing pressure on 3rd and 5. Burmeister flushed, rolls, and throws at time, and he finds Robinson. Tavion Robinson with a first down play on the final play of the quarter. Man, Burmeister bought so much time and then threw at the last moment to find Robinson. And a first down play for the Hokies. And that's the end of the first quarter. West Virginia raced out to a quick lead. The Hokies answered on the move as we go to the second quarter in a one-score game in Morgantown.
Take a look at this last play to convert on third down. Burmeister talked to us last night about him loving Johnny Manziel and being in middle school and watching him play. This is a Johnny Manziel-esque type play where he goes through his reads, he gets to the outside, and then he's close to out of bounds and knows where he is and throws the ball. The cardinal rule, don't throw it back. But I tell the young quarterbacks I work with, if there's a guy open, you get that ball to him safely, and he does that, and he converts.
You know who would throw it back? Johnny Football.
Johnny Manziel.
He would do that.
Calculated risk taker is what I like to call quarterbacks. Calculated risk taker. You take a look at the defense, right, because you're a talented runner. You're fast. You're in no danger. You're going out of bounds. Make sure that it's safe. Make the throw.
And officials did take a look to confirm that Burmeister was not out of bounds. And great work by our crew because it clearly still had a little bit of space before the sideline.
I mean, that's the danger of that dual threat, true dual threat quarterback. Burmeister wanted to come into this game and show his throwing ability, but he still has his legs, and he's using them to find throws like he did on that last play.
West Virginia raced out to a 14-0 lead. Hokies answered back. A touchdown pass from Burmeister to Robinson. Now the Hokies on the move as we start the second quarter.
Corey, remember when I told you that I chose not to play defense because of those big running backs? But also because of quarterbacks like that that make you cover for almost 10 seconds before the ball comes out. I wouldn't be surprised if they take a shot here, right? Just go lean into Burmeister. Lean into him.
Burmeister looking and will just go down. No gain in the play. Dante Stills gets some help up onto his feet. Good coverage that time of the West Virginia secondary.
No gain on the play, and it is one of Burmeister's best plays of the day. They call a shot just like I expected, and he doesn't make a bad play worse. Right, they covered us. Right, find a way to try to create, but don't do too much. Right, get down. Don't take a shot you don't need to take. Go to second and long and try to get something back.
Burmeister on the roll. He'll run, and he's out of bounds inside the 30-yard line, setting up about third down and maybe about 4. Chandler Cimino escorted Burmeister out of bounds. So once again, a 4, call it 3rd and 6.
This 3rd and 6 is pretty big, and his legs, right, are still going to be a part of it. The West Virginia defense just had to chase him for 2 straight plays, right? How much gas do they have left in the tank if he takes off, and he's in empty right now, so it's a big, big option.
Hokies 2-4 on third down. Here's Robinson. And he's brought down about a yard, yard and a half shy by Alonzo Adai. So fourth down here, decision time for the Hokies. What do you think, Devin?
The way my offense is playing, I leave him out there and I give him a shot with my explosive quarterback running the football. That looks like that's what they're going to do.
Hokies have only attempted one fourth down conversion all year. They were successful. And Burmeister staying out there.
Think about this, four straight snaps of chasing side to side, side to side. The West Virginia defense is not fresh. Let's see if they keep the ball in Burmeister's hands and allow him to go get a yard.
Fourth and one. Burmeister, he didn't get it. Sean Mahone and the Mountaineer defense makes a stop on fourth down.
He didn't get it, but they're leaning into their quarterback, and you have to do it. You have to, in this environment, give it an opportunity to try to get the first down. But that West Virginia defense slammed Burmeister.
Sponsored by Edward Jones. Life is for living. Let's partner for all of it. So after a fourth down stop, Mountaineers get the ball back, leading by seven early second quarter. Buddy Brown lined up first. Top of your screen now joins Daigie in the backfield. And Brown is wrapped up after a short gain. Tackled by Norrell Pollard. Buddy Brown, 80-yard touchdown run. And the second play from scrimmage for the Mountaineers today. And the ground game, rather quiet after 2 weeks, but that ground game got a big jolt from Letty Brown in the opening quarter. Yeah, West Virginia did get Tony Mathis Jr. back this week to help out in the ground game. It's Brown again with a cutback lane. And he's brought down by Connor and company, along with Alan Tisdale, after a 5-yard gain. There's a flag.
Illegal motion, offense number one, 5-yard penalty, second down.
That's now the fifth penalty already on West Virginia. Those are piling up here in this first half as Brown was shaken up on that last carry.
And it's such small details, right, where you have one guy in motion and you get another guy moving just a bit, and now it creates, you can't have two guys in motion when you're running your plays.
So you see 24 there, that is Tony Mathis Jr. Did not play last week, got banged up in the Maryland game. Redshirt sophomore, former Orlando, comes in as Brown comes out. From the 23. Daigie, deep ball down the middle. Incomplete, was looking for right. Coverage from Tade Daly.
Man, Daigie wishes he had that one back, right? Similar to the Chiefs and how they use their receivers. You get your guy in motion, you get him on that deep cross. It's hard to cover, but he just misses him.
Tate Daly on the coverage there, starting at safety today. The Hokies without Keonta Jenkins, again with an injured foot. So Daly comes out on third and long. And Letty Brown is back in for West Virginia.
Look for a screen to Letty Brown.
It's there, and here it is. Brown. Brown near first down. We'll see on the spot, and they're going to mark him short.
Yeah, he slipped, and his leg swung out of bounds and swiped the white, looked like. All right, so he looks like he's going to get it here. He looks like he's going to get it, and then you get him nicked on the heel by Dax. And then his foot sweeps on the outside, just out of bounds, short of the first down.
Needed 12 and picked up about 11.
How about that effort, though, for Dax, right? Dax Hollifield going across the field and making sure he stops that screen before it gets to the first down marker.
So Tavion Robinson back to receive this punt. from Tyler Sumpter.
Something cool about Dax Holifield, you know, he was the MVP of a state title game in high school. 16 tackles and a sack. 16 tackles in one game in the state championship. The biggest stage of his life to that point, and he has 16 tackles.
His brother Jack is an offensive lineman. His dad, Aubrey, was a defensive tackle at Wake Forest.
Football in his blood.
So a delay of game, pushes the ball back. 5 more yards. Hokies showing pressure. Here they come. And Sumpter gets it off, and a great punt.
Wow.
Inside the 10-yard line.
And it's rolling.
Still rolling.
And it's rolling.
Down to the 3-yard line. A 68-yard punt from Tyler Sumpter. And that pins the Hokies back in a 7-point game. Timeout in Morgantown. Week 3 of the college football season, and we have a rivalry renewed today. So many great names and faces and moments over the years. And we've already had quite a few so far today in the 53rd renewal of Virginia Tech and West Virginia. Movement up front.
Ball start. Offense. Number 79. The penalty is half the distance to the goal line.
It's on Tyrell Smith. Well, West Virginia leading and feeling momentum following the career-long 68-yard punt from the Troy transfer Tyler Sumpter.
Yeah, I mean, he's in true Pat McAfee fashion, right? Swinging bats and doing all kinds of stuff because he has his Virginia Tech team backed up.
And Blackshear brought down at the 3 by Adai and Stevens. See the numbers on Burmeister today. 8 of 9, 83 yards.
So they want to try to throw the ball here because the run game, the West Virginia is just there. So they're probably going to try to get on the edge.
It's Blackshear up the middle, and he slithers his way across the 5. Gain of 3, Akeem Mesidor. Preseason all Big 12 selection made the stop. 3rd and 6.
Burmeister's thrown those outside comebacks very well. He's made good decisions in the drop-back passing game. Let's see if they don't allow him to do that and take it down here where it's free access.
Burmeister, sideline, incomplete. Intended for Turner. So following the punt, a penalty, and Virginia Tech will punt from its own end zone.
It's a big-time win for the West Virginia defense. Flying around, making plays, stopping the run game, forcing Burmeister to try to put the ball in the air with his back against the wall. And like we talked about, he's not going to make mistakes, right? He's going to do his best to take care of the ball, which you have to do when you're in the black zone.
Peter Moore, big leg, punter, low snap. And he got it off. Estale, fair catch inside the West Virginia 45-yard line. Good punt there for Moore. He's averaging about 43 per punt. That one went for 50. We are 9:39 to go until halftime. West Virginia 14, 15th ranked Virginia Tech 7. Fifth drive about to begin, Devin, for the Mountaineers. It will start with Garrett Green.
Yeah, they're going to try and get a change of pace, right? Put the runner in, allow him to try to create a spark for your offense that stalled the last 2 drives.
Green threw 7 passes last week. This will be his 2nd run. And he works inside Hokie territory. Brought down by Devin Hunter. That'll be near a 1st down.
That's so difficult for a defense because they prepare all week for a passer who's not going to run much. And then you insert Garrett Green, and he's able to make plays with his feet, especially on design quarterback runs.
Neil Brown first offered Garrett Green when he was still coaching at Troy.
The issue is you can't just commit to the run because he can't throw the ball.
And now he lost it. It's on the turf. He picks it up and just chucks it into his own sideline.
You You want him to feel this snap, but that snap is low below the knees. It's very tough to make quick decisions and have sound ball security when the ball is below the knees.
So Green stays in on second and 10.
There's shots available all over the field, man to man, across the board. Man to man, man to man.
It's Brown, and that is snuffed out by the Hokie front line. Jordan Williams, transfer from Clemson. His first year as a Hokie, made the stop. Third down, no gain.
Corey, I don't think you can allow Virginia Tech to play this way. They're playing zero, right? They're playing with no safety in the middle of the field, man-to-man across the board. Now they're going to have a safety back, but you cannot allow them to get away with playing that type of defense at this level.
On third and 10, Devin Green comes out. Daigie back in. Daigie, plenty of time. There's a deep shot. Open near the 20-yard line. That's caught by Sam James. Daigie had time, a window, and he found James for a first down play.
Daigie caught him in a zone defense, and they just run a corner route. It's a sail concept where the outside guy is going to take the top off the defense, and then the slot runs kind of a rolled out corner like a banana shape to try to get in the opening of the zone.
It's a 30-yard pass and catch. Daigie to James, a guy the West Virginia coaching staff said has made a huge jump in his progress from the start of camp. First and 10, Daigie looking end zone. Incomplete, intended for Sean Ryan.
Their plan of creating a spark with Garrett Green worked, right? He came in, had a nice run, and then he got stalled a couple plays, and you bring in another quarterback, right? So the defense has to change their whole mentality of how they're going to cover. Throws a first down, and now they're moving and in the red zone.
And where is Daigie so good and effective? In the pocket.
Absolutely.
And he had time. First red zone trip for either team that we've had, 21 points so far. On second and 10. That's caught by James. James into the end zone. Touchdown, West Virginia. Yard touchdown play. The third touchdown reception for Sam James, the redshirt junior from Georgia.
Nothing fancy here, just going to be a hitch route, and the off coverage allows him to get the ball, and then the rest is all James. He makes a miss and gets in the end zone swiftly.
A rare missed tackle from Jamari Connor. Also got around Nasir Peoples, the Hokies' leading tackler, and West Virginia regains the 14-point lead. James, the touchdown catch. Mountaineers lead by 14 midway through the second quarter. Virginia, 7:44 remaining until that State Farm halftime show. Scoring drive, six plays, 57 yards. Daigie, second touchdown. Throw this one to Sam James. Here. And it's popped at the 25-yard line. The Mountaineers playing well at home, which is nothing new going back to 2020. Devin, look at the numbers. West Virginia has played awfully well at Milan Puskás Stadium, averaging 41 points per game, allowing just 11 points per game since 2020 in Morgantown.
Corey, safe to say they feel comfortable at home, and you can see that comfortability on full display this afternoon.
This game was sold out for months, 60,000 strong. This rivalry moves to Lane Stadium in Blacksburg next season. Trey Turner trying to slip away and stretches out for a gain of close to five. Burmeister rolling, running, near first down. Chased out by Scotty Young Jr.
That speed.
Don't be short.
That speed. That speed on the edge. You know, they talk about it. He's the fastest guy on the team, but there's some discrepancy with the fastest guy on the team. He was tracked as the fastest runner. He has his GPS. But everybody, as we know, Corey, didn't have on GPS. But, you know, I think Burmeister's comfortable saying he's the fastest guy on the team.
Well, let's see what the call is here for Burmeister and the Hokies on third and one. Holston up the middle, and the ball comes out. It's recovered for a moment by West Virginia, but then the ball came out again. Boy, Lance Dixon, 5, had it for West Virginia, and then he lost it. Recovered by Virginia Tech. Looked like Burmeister's the one that...
out of nowhere, he dives in, right? You can see it's not the exchange, right? It's a tackle on the runner. The ball pops out. Lance Dixon comes flying in and jumps on it. And then Burmeister, it just lands right in his face as he's sliding in trying to get it after him. That they dodged a bullet there. Virginia Tech dodged a bullet.
Now, Josh Chandler-Sumito is the one that punched it out. And West Virginia has only forced one turnover all year. Nearly got number two. It leads to a punt from Moore. And Estale has wrapped up this special teams play by the Hokies. Devon Hunter made the tackle. We'll keep it here with 5:34 to go. And West Virginia has the ball back, leading 21-7.
West Virginia's coming out in a position to try and put Virginia Tech away, right? Take them down. 3 touchdowns. Sudden change. Almost got a big turnover. I would not be surprised for them if I don't see them. Daigie put the ball in the air down the field with this man defense.
And West Virginia will get the ball first to begin the second half. All 3 timeouts. 5:34 to go until halftime. Daigie took a hit. Still found. Estale makes a great spin. Isaiah Estale, a stutter step, and then shoved out near midfield. But Daigie hung in there, took a hit, but still found Estale for a big first down play.
Can you stand in the face of adversity and take a shot and deliver? Daigie proves right there that he can.
It was Jalen Griffin that came from the blind side that provided the pop on Daigie, but Tough hung in there. And the ball is out near midfield. Daigie now 7 of 12 passing, 130 yards and 2 scores. That one's tipped in the air and incomplete. Deflected by Jermaine Waller. Boy, he's a good player, Devin. We spoke with him last night.
Yeah, Jermaine Waller is as talented as they come. And he hasn't been able to make a play today, but that's his first opportunity. You always got a time there, right? So when I was the quarterback, you know, back in the day, I'd like to get on the edge and throw a little pump fake right in his face and then run around him. Daigie didn't do it there. He'll probably get him with it next time.
Yeah, great to see Waller back. He missed most of last season, only 2 games after being named an honorable mention All-ACC performer in 2019. On 2nd and 10, it's Estale in traffic and slips away and then is brought down. And around the 46 by Griffin and Tisdale.
Yeah, Jermaine Waller, let's go back to him. He's very talented at getting his hands on footballs, just like you saw there. In high school, he was a quarterback. He passed for 2,600 yards and 24 touchdowns. So you can see some of that savvy and some of those brains that he uses on the defensive side of the ball to help him understand what quarterbacks are trying to do to him and for him to counter.
West Virginia, 1 of 3 on 3rd down. Pressure coming. Daigie throws high. It's caught. Keeping his feet is Winston Wright Jr. as he surges across the 40-yard line for a first down.
What a play. It's kind of a pick route where he's going to run outside, he's going to run inside and then come back out. He catches the ball here, and then this is all him, right? Just keeping his balance, right? You can see on the kickoff return, he made a decision to take the ball out of the end zone because he wants to make a play. Here, he does it again, and he maybe...
Look at that right, foot. Out of bounds. West Virginia is going fast here. That was close.
Sigh of relief.
Up the middle, this is Brown.
I don't even know if West Virginia even thought, right? They were moving very, very casually, not recognizing that maybe their pass catcher might have stepped out of bounds, but they get away with one there.
It was close. It was close. But we play on a six-yard gain for Letty Brown. Fifth play of the drive upcoming. And now there's an injured Hokie on the field. That's Alan Tisdale, 34. Shoe came off.
West Virginia guys are not happy about that, right? They're like, we're rolling, and his shoe comes off. He has to play without a shoe. I've seen Denard Robinson run down the field without a shoe many days. Yeah, his teammate says, get down, but that's not an injury, right? That's an equipment issue.
So second down and four. As Daigie comes under center. There's Brown. Brown across the 30. First down run for Letty Brown.
Why wait to get to third down, right? Convert on second down, right? Treat second down like a third down and get the first down. Letty Brown has been special today, to say the least.
Seven carries, 105 yards rushing for Letty Brown. As a team, West Virginia, 121 yards rushing already. They were averaging 123 after two games. Tisdale back in, by the way. Comes in a blitz. Daigie lets it fly, incomplete, as he was pressured. And now a flag comes in late. Jordan Williams on the hit. And the flag came in late.
Yeah, he hit him on time, but he gave him a little extra while he's on the ground. But I love that play by Daigie. I love it. Right, knowing exactly where your guys are. You call a shot play with big play action. You know where your guy is going. So within the pocket, you can just chuck it because you know you're not going to get an intentional grounding. That's knowing the offense. That's the maturation that you see from Daigie in this season.
Against the defense, personal foul, face mask. Defense number two, penalties declined. Personal foul, roughing the passer. Defense number 12, 15-yard penalty. First down.
It's the fourth penalty on Virginia Tech in this first half. They had five penalties total after two games.
Like I said, I think the hit is on time, right? He hits him, but he gives a little extra. You can't give that extra to the quarterbacks. And then you got a face mask by the best defender on the Virginia Tech defense. Hold his guy. I mean, he didn't mean it. He let it go eventually. And then you got to hold him there as well. I mean, it's a plethora of penalties on the field for the Virginia Tech defense. They're reeling right now, right? Because West Virginia is rolling. They found their groove in the run and the pass game. Daigie is playing about as good as he's played all season.
Does West Virginia go right to the end zone here, keep that momentum going?
That's what I do.
James in motion. It's a run for Brown. Brown across the five and dragged down near the two.
Letty Brown said, I got it. I'll put it toward the end zone if you guys want it there. Having himself a day, and it started off with the second play of the game, and he hasn't slowed down since.
Mountaineers trying to go fast here.
They're not afraid to throw fades, but I think they'll leave the ball in Letty Brown's hands. Oh, they are.
Daigie, here's the fade, and too far for Estill.
See, that's what happens when you're a quarterback and you second-guess yourself, Devin. You knew they were throwing the fade. Daigie saw that they didn't have it well covered by Virginia Tech's cornerback. Puts the ball out of bounds. Move on to second down.
Hear the Letty chants.
Letty chants. We want Letty. We want Letty. He hears it too.
Look at him nod his head up and down.
West Virginia's player, hey, could you quiet down a little bit? Trying to get a play called here.
West Virginia just got it off. It's Dagey rolling, slips away, and is brought down for a loss. Eli Adams has come up with a couple of big plays. Redshirt sophomore from Rock Hill, South Carolina, made the play defensively.
Yeah, they're going to have a naked bootleg going here, and Dagey just cannot get outside. He's not the runner that Green is, so in that situation, he's at a disadvantage with a linebacker chasing.
A timeout was called with a minute 49 to play and a third and goal upcoming for West Virginia. Well, tomorrow, George Kittle leads the Niners against the Eagles, or Matt Ryan and the Falcons take on Tom Brady and the defending champion Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Check local listings for the game in your area only on Fox and the Fox Sports app.
It's going to be a pretty good quarterback matchup there, huh? I don't know how Matt Ryan feels about it. It wasn't the last time out, but everybody remembers 28-3. And Tom Brady on Instagram gave a little dig at that 28-3. Had 28-3 on the clock. 328, right, on the clock. It wasn't 328, Tom. Don't you do that. He's been great on the internet.
That's one Michigan man to another. Absolutely. Right there. So there's some love there.
Yeah.
Man. Letty Brown, what a day he's had. 80-yard touchdown run, the second play from scrimmage for West Virginia today. Winston Wright Jr. in motion on third and goal. Dagey, time, rolls towards the end zone. James, is he in?
Waiting for the signal. He is in. He is in. They haven't signaled just yet. Oh, let's look at it. Does his toes come down before his heels? It looks like his toes come down before his heels.
It's been ruled incomplete. It was ruled an incomplete pass. And there's the right foot. The right foot of James is out of bounds. So let's bring in for the first time today our rules expert, the great Mike Pereira from Los Angeles. And Mike, the ruling on the field is an incomplete pass, negating a touchdown.
And I think it is incomplete, because here's the issue. When it's a natural stepping motion, either going backwards, toe, heel, or going forward, heel, toe, the whole foot has to be in bounds. And it looks to me here that it is the classic toe, heel. Toe hits first, but then heel hits on the line. So to me, it's a tremendous call, and it's an incomplete pass.
Yeah, Mike, that's hard to call, right? When everything's going fast, you see that toe come down first.
Yeah, and that's the whole issue. If it's a toe drag, that's okay. That's a different story.
Very much so.
A natural stepping motion. The theory being it's so hard to tell in a step that on all levels, NCAA and NFL, if it's toe heel or heel toe, the whole foot's got to be in bounds.
Well, Mike, that's why we have you here, the expert.
Well, I'm happy to help out. That's why I'm here in the studios in LA.
In the business.
All right, Mike, thank you. Great to have you with us all day long. So fourth and goal upcoming. Riley Johnson.
Corey, I think that's a little known rule, right? A lot of people don't know when that toe comes down, the whole foot has to come down.
The ruling on the field stands.
Incomplete pass. So fourth and goal. See if West Virginia will take the three here again. The Mountaineers get the ball first to begin the second half.
Yeah, they're going to be comfortable with three.
And Casey Legg is on. This is a 21-yard try. He's a high school soccer player in Charleston, West Virginia. 2-2 on the year. And now make it three out of three. A 21-yard field goal. 24-7. West Virginia timeout in Morgantown. 24-7 West Virginia. Sam James nearly had a touchdown, but ruled incomplete correctly. And Casey Legg with a 21-yard field goal. And Virginia Tech will get the ball back. Justin Fuente. And the Hokies off to a 2-0 start. Last time Virginia Tech was 3-0. It was in 2017. The Hokies have two timeouts. Return from Blackshear. Nice return for Blackshear. Cut back. Blackshear down the middle. Raheem Blackshear near the 22-yard line. Virginia Tech synonymous with special team performance, and Raheem Blackshear with a great return for the Hokies late in the first half.
You need a response when you have a long drive like West Virginia just did, and the returner responds right here. Just flies straight down the middle of the field. Wants to take it to the house, but he ran out of gas there. Lane integrity is so important for West Virginia on the kickoff, and they did not have it on that play.
Calling it a 78-yard return. So Virginia Tech gets a spark from Blackshear. And now Burmeister rolling out and nowhere to go.
Seems like it's been forever since we've seen Burmeister on the field, right?
Actually, Virginia Tech with a three-minute edge in time of possession. But think about the first quarter. You know, West Virginia, two scores in five plays. Yeah. Two touchdowns in five plays.
Yeah.
Keeps his feet, and he'll run just shy of the first down marker. Gain of nine. It'll be third down.
Calm and poised in the pocket. He looks to his left to throw a slant. They have two over one, and he can't get to it, and he escapes just by the hair on his chin to get outside, get out of bounds, and set up a third and one.
And Vandarius Cowan, Richard senior transfer from Alabama, thought he had Burmeister. On third and one, this is Holston up the middle. He'll pick up a hard-earned first down. Physical run from Holston. Tackled by X-Ray Lowe. Gain of two. Looks like Fuente wants the Hokies to pick up the tempo here. Two timeouts left. Holston stays in. It is first and goal from the 10. Burmeister towards the end zone. Open, sliding, scooping, and scoring is Robinson. Touchdown, Virginia Tech. 2nd score for Tavion Robinson. And off the big return from Blackshear, Burmeister finds Robinson for 10.
They go play action. You get guys on the West Virginia defense just looking in the backfield, right? Not responding to receivers running right behind them. Burmeister finds his receiver.
And they might take a look. Did that ball hit the ground?
Looked like it could have skipped, but it could have skipped off his hands.
First ruling was a touchdown.
That's going to be hard to overturn, Corey. It looks like it bounces, but his hand is on the ground. Looks like he bounces off of his hand and into his arms. Looks like that ball might have been tipped just a little bit at the line of scrimmage as well.
It was Dante Stills who had his hands up, Devin, and perhaps got a piece of it as we look at it.
Because Burmeister's proven that he can throw this football, right? So it's a little low, and he's wide open. You wonder why. It's because it's tipped. But it looks like he might have gotten his hands underneath. Oh, that's the view. That's the view. That's hard to overturn for me. That's hard. Right, if it's called an incompletion, right, I feel like it's hard to overturn it that way, too. But because it's called a completion, they looked at each other, they got with the call. It's tough.
Let's go back to Los Angeles once again. Bring in Mike Pereira. Mike, Tavion Robinson, he believes that's a clean catch. How about you?
Yeah, you know, it's so tough because really with the dark end zone there, it's hard to see if the hands are underneath the ball. My sense is that it hit the ground, but I just can't tell for sure if the hands were underneath the ball. This is a really tight one.
So Mike, because you can't tell for sure, it's called complete. Does it
you know, he just clarified, guys, it has been ruled an incomplete pass.
Oh,
so this
really?
Would need to be overturned. So it was ruled incomplete, Mike. That was what the official ruling on the field was.
Yeah, and again, you know, you're always, we all sit here in the studio here and we go, well, man, I think it is. I think it may have hit the ground. That's usually where you stay with the call. And I really, in my mind, if I'm the replay official here, my sense is I still say that it hit the ground, but I'm just not sure based on the shot of the ball and the darkness of the paint in the end zone that you can really tell.
So at first we thought it was a clean catch touchdown. Officials got together, ruled incomplete. So a long look here from Riley Johnson.
Gotta love all those camera angles, right? To try to get it right. Right, that's a big play in this game, right? That's a touchdown. Now you cut this lead a little bit before the half with the Mountaineers getting the ball coming back out.
Robinson, his nickname is Sweet Feet. Needed some sweet hands to make that scoop.
He didn't need his sweet feet because the Mountaineers just didn't cover him.
Justin Fuente anxiously awaiting the call. Here it is.
After further review, the ruling on the field stands. Game clock operator, let's put 58 seconds back up on the game clock. Thank you. 58 seconds.
Thank you. So it is an incomplete pass.
Yeah. And the wording is important, right? Stands, just like Mike talked about. It's hard to overturn it when you call the incompletion on the field.
Raheem Blackshear now the tailback to Burmeister's right.
The legs of Burmeister are very important here, even in the passing situations.
And right on cue, Devin, here comes Burmeister. Lowers the shoulder and brought down inside the 5-yard line by Scotty Young Jr. Clock running, 2 timeouts left, 48 seconds, 3rd and goal.
Now, in a short yardage situation a few times ago, they didn't get the first down because they sent Burmeister straight up in the middle of the West Virginia defense. Now, if they do choose to keep the ball in Burmeister's hands, they'll probably get him on the edge so he can use his speed and beat the defense to the pylon.
Burmeister's been good on third down. Those numbers there. Clock is running. Virginia Tech with 2 timeouts. Did not use one here. And now it has been halted at 21 seconds. So Virginia Tech will have 1 timeout left.
That's interesting, right? You're going to take these timeouts into the half with you, right? Get a play right now to get a first down. Leaving themselves 2 opportunities, right? 2 opportunities at the end zone or field goal.
Safe Farm Halftime Show with Mike and the guys coming up next from Los Angeles. West Virginia leading Virginia Tech 24-7. So Burmeister, Hokie fans made the trip from Blacksburg. Not an easy ticket. This one sold out months ago. All right, Devin, 3rd and goal. What's the call here for the Hokies and Burmeister?
Burmeister left, Burmeister right in the run pass option. Right, give him a chance to get on the edge, use his speed, or find an open target.
And now let's see if West Virginia is going to call a timeout, and it will do that just to see what the Hokies showed. So the Mountaineers take their first timeout. See the quarterback comparison, Dagey and Burmeister, Devin, here in the first half.
Yeah, both of them very efficient, doing their jobs, haven't turned the ball over just yet. So that's exactly what you want from your quarterbacks, right? Obviously, Daigie has had a few more big plays through the year, but Burmeister has been a general out there, and he's in complete control. Now, this play coming up, remember earlier in the game when we had the quarterback play action, right, where he faked the quarterback power, right, and tried to dump the ball over top. Don't be surprised if they don't hit number 86, Nick Gallo, over the top, right, after a play action from the quarterback himself.
Now, remember, speaking of Gallo, one of the Virginia Tech tight ends, the Hokies without leader, great player, James Mitchell, done for the rest of the season. He'll have knee surgery here in the coming days. It's a big loss for the Hokies on the field, off the field. So the tight end duo right now, Drake Dulius and Nick Gallo, have to step up for the Hokies.
There's Gallo right there.
And the Mountaineers call their second timeout.
Gotta love the game of chess on a football field. All right, we got these timeouts. Let's keep trying.
Now, just talking about James Mitchell, 6'3 junior. What a career he's had. Out for the season, hurt his knee against Middle Tennessee State last week. And he will have season-ending surgery here in the coming days. Coach, it's a big loss.
Coach Puente was pretty dejected, you know, when we were talking to him about not only him as a player, but him as a leader, right? They said they're missing a bunch of leadership. And you can see, usually you don't travel an injured guy to a away game, but they traveled him because he means that much to the team, not only on offense, but on defense with his leadership.
So West Virginia called back-to-back timeouts. Now some movement. Mountaineers pointing Virginia Tech's way.
False start. Offense. Number 79. 5 yard.
That's one on Tyrell Smith. In there for the injured Silas Janzy. That's five Virginia Tech penalties in this first half for a team that just had five all season after two games. Does that change the play call here now, third and goal?
Well, it looked like they were going to just try and throw a regular old fade, but now you're going to try and get a combination up here with these three receivers.
Of the five Hokie penalties, three false starts, and now West Virginia is going to burn its final timeout.
We've heard of icing the kicker, but how about icing the quarterback in his offense? I mean, just, hey, why go into the half with these timeouts? Figure it out, get it right, find a way to stop them here on third down. Make that offense think about what they want to do, right? Show us the formation, and we'll take a timeout to talk it over.
Now, we spoke about the rivalry with Justin Puente yesterday, and he said, it's great, but if it's going to be here, I want it to stay here. Yeah. Not just a habit.
In and
every so often, a return trip to Blacksburg next year. Then beyond that, who knows? But before today, last time they met, it was a neutral site game in 2017, and so much great history between these two programs, from the Southern Conference to the Big East days. Don Nealon and Frank Beamer, Rich Rod and Frank Beamer. It's great for football. On third and goal, Burmeister throws incomplete. Could not connect with Robinson.
He had him. He just missed him.
Injury timeout.
That's Scotty Young Jr. down. Linebacker for West Virginia. Now, West Virginia and Virginia Tech, this has become a trophy game, and they play for the Black Diamond Trophy. They have done that since 1997. Virginia Tech has won the last three. There's a happy Frank Beamer.
How about those offensive linemen holding it like it's, you know, like a paperweight, and Frank Beamer is holding it like it's a couch from your living room. Yeah, that's the strength of those offensive linemen, defensive linemen. It's a pretty cool trophy, too, right? The Black Diamond.
It is.
That's really cool.
Great to have that trophy referencing the region's history with the coal industry.
Mm-hmm.
Neil Brown has one win over a ranked team and now two plus seasons at West Virginia. That was against Kansas State last year. Let's take a look at where and how Scotty Young Jr. got banged up. 19 in gold.
Oh, that's where it happens always when you get a running back cutting you down, right? Trying to protect his quarterback. They put in a lot of rules with cutting and adjacent sidelines and different things like that. Good to see him up and walking off the field on his own, under his own power. But they've made the game a little safer with different rules that don't allow you to cut in different areas of the field. But that's still an area where a running back is allowed to cut.
So this was set up a short field goal try, 25 yards for John Parker Romo. Originally competed at Tulsa, third year now with the Hokies, and that's no good. He missed it right. His second miss this season, and Dante Stills and the Mountaineers are fired up with 12 seconds to go until halftime.
That illegal procedure penalty is much bigger now because you push yourself back and then the kicker just shanks it off to the right of the goalpost. Pre-snap penalties are what kill teams' opportunities to win football games, and it drives coaches crazy. And as you can see, that West Virginia special teams is ecstatic.
And think about the momentum shift that we saw when it appeared that Tavion Robinson had the touchdown catch. It was ruled incomplete, went to review, and the call stood. And then Virginia Tech was hoping to settle for three, but John Parker Romo missed his chip shot field goal, and now Daigie will take a knee, and West Virginia will head to half, leading 24-7. An amazing first half for the Mountaineers. What adjustments will the Hokies make? The State Farm Halftime Show is coming up after the break.
All right, welcome inside our LA studios. I'm your dream, I'm straight. I'm your ass when you're away. I'm your pain while you say. Don't say it but true. Say it but true. Say it but true.
Halftime score from Morgantown, West Virginia 24, 15th ranked Virginia Tech 7. As we welcome you back to college football here in FS1, Corey Provis back with Devin Gardner. And the Mountaineers, Devin, built a sizable first half lead thanks to some quick early plays today.
Yeah, I mean, they play well on both sides of the ball. On defense with those yellow jerseys and helmets, they're like killer bees running around chasing the ball. And then on offense, it's been Daigie and Letty Brown. It starts off with Letty Brown with a huge run of 80 yards for a touchdown, and then Daigie has done a great job of protecting the ball. The next play after that big run that you're watching right now, a big throw from Daigie. So the quarterback and the running back, the two people we needed to play well for the West Virginia Mountaineers to play well, they're doing it.
Yeah, turnover free first half on all sides. And Jared Daigie has been spreading the ball around.
Yeah, everybody's touched it. And the one thing that we wanted to see him do is not press, right? Not try to take things too far, not try to be a superhero. He's done that, and it's been very conducive to the success of West Virginia as they receive the opening kickoff.
As you look at the first half for the Mountaineers, getting the ground game going has been tough, but not today. They were averaging just about 123 on the ground. Their first two games surpassed that in the first half today. So Mountaineers get the ball. Winston Wright Jr. on the return. And Wright is tackled shy of the 20-yard line. Now West Virginia With an outstanding first half offensively, and those numbers, Devin, back it up right there.
Yeah, the aforementioned Jarrett Daigie and Lady Brown, right, doing exactly what they're asked to do and what their team needs them to do to be successful today. Most important stat there, no turnovers.
Daigie in his 16th start with the Mountaineers. From the 18. And Virginia Tech with a strong start defensively. Letty Brown hit in the backfield and a loss of one. Narelle Pollard and Ellen Tisdale combined on the stop.
Second down from 11, 17.
Top of your screen, that's tight end Michael Laughlin. His first action of 2021. Coaching staff hoping to get him in for about 20 plays today as Brown slips free. First down, a hurdle near the 40-yard line.
Anytime Lady Brown lines up on the outside, you got to be wary of getting him the ball. They get it to him here, and look at the hurdle. Oh, he tries to stick the landing, but isn't able to do it, man. He's explosive. We talked about him at halftime. We talked about him all through the first half, and he comes in and makes a splash early to start this half.
Yeah, such a weapon on all sides in terms of the offensive scheme, running, receiving. Man, Brown having a big afternoon, stays in. Play clock under five. On first down, deep drop, Daigie, and throws it away. Pass intended for Letty Brown.
Looked like it was a bit of confusion between Letty Brown and Daigie and the rest of the receivers of what the play call was actually going to be. Good job by Daigie, not making a bad play worse, getting the ball over the head of his intended target.
The 42 on second down, they'll fake it, throw over the middle, perfect strike to Sean Ryan, and the flag comes in late.
They're going to get the defender for targeting. They're going to take a look at it, but the play action, which it looks like RPO, but it's a play action, right? He's going to throw that ball the entire time, puts the ball in the belly of the running back, and then drives it on the face mask of his receiver. Very good job to start this half for Daigie.
The flag probably is going to be on Tate Daly. Safety for Virginia Tech.
Personal foul, targeting defense number 17. 15-yard penalty, and that play is under further review.
So the offensive line is not going to go in run blocking situations. So you're just going to have a slant right here. Little tug of the jersey air, but a nice catch. And then they're like they're going to overturn that, right? He went with his shoulder. It just looked very dangerous up high. It looks like he moved his head out of the way. Maybe Mike will think something a little different.
Let's bring in Mike Pereira now from Los Angeles. Mike, you've had a chance to take a look at it. Targeting was called on the field. What do you think?
Yeah, first of all, you have to go to the category. What is he? Is he a runner or a defenseless player? And in the receiver situation here, has he completed the catch? And has he had time enough to protect himself? If he is defenseless, then you're talking about contact to the head or neck area. And if you put him in the category of the runner, then it has to be the pure crown of the helmet. To me, I think really this is to the upper back, you know, in the shoulder area. I kind of don't like it for something that should lead to an ejection. But if they're going to do this in terms of calling him defenseless, then I guess you could make the case. But I don't like it as targeting, but they may stay with it.
After further review, there is no foul for targeting.
And Mike, let's keep it with you there for a moment. I understand why they threw the flag. Just watching Ryan's head just kind of whip around in the manner that it did, I think is what the officials saw and threw the flag.
Yeah, there's no question about that, Corey. To me, you have to react on the contact. And I tell you, not only does it look bad, but it sounds bad. And this is the back judge that makes the call, so you react to that. And the safety net that they put in for targeting is just for this reason. You can understand why it's called, but you wouldn't want to eject the player for the rest of this half and the first half of the next game when it's questionable. And that did their job there using replay.
It's a nice violent hit, and violent legal hit by Daly.
He comes out after the first down play.
He's going to throw.
This might be a throw from Esdale, but he loses his footing, and down he goes as the Mountaineers go backwards. There's Dax Hollifield, the co-captain, a loss of 8.
Ah, West Virginia tried to sneak one in there. A little swing pass thrown backwards so that the catcher can throw the ball. That's the attention to detail here. The ball has to be thrown in a backward motion so that now he can still be a passer. He doesn't make a bad play worse, so Virginia Tech has it covered. Very good job on both sides of the ball, playing really good football.
Estelle, the redshirt senior from Newark. Newark, Delaware. On second down and 17, it's Brown. And he's tackled by Adams and Josh Fuga after a gain of 7.
West Virginia fans will remember a running back that wore this same uniform, Javid Best.
Good name, great player.
This running back, Brown, reminds me a lot of Javid Best, right? We've seen him run between the tackles. We've seen him hit the home run. We've seen him catch out of the backfield, right? A lot of the same things Javid Best did. He looks in the same mode.
It's third down and 10. It's Brown up the middle, and he'll power forward across the 35. This will be about fourth and short, though.
Yeah, when you make that call, you're anticipating going forward on fourth down.
So a gain of 7 officially, so it's a 4th and 3. And West Virginia is keeping the offense on the field. Now the Mountaineers, from going for it on 4th down, are 4 out of 6.
Analytics have creeped its way into football, and that's a favorable position to go for it and think you might be able to get it.
So Daigie throws quickly. That's caught. That's O'Loughlin. And a first down for West Virginia. Suffered a lower leg injury earlier. Did not play the first 2 weeks. That's his 22nd career reception.
Just a quick out by O'Loughlin right here to the outside. He's going to get a natural pick from his wide receiver. Blitz from the cornerback allows him to be free to the outside.
Redshirt junior from Glen Ellyn, Illinois.
How about Daigie, right? Remember earlier he had a pass batted down by Jermaine Waller. That time he navigates the throw and gets it to his tight end for a big first down.
Bad snap, and Daigie just pounces on top of it.
That bad snap reared his ugly head earlier when Green was in the game, and here it is again. This one's a little worse, right? It's low and outside. Great job by Daigie getting an opportunity to fall on it and not make a bad play worse.
So a loss of 7.
Unforced errors. Keels drives.
West Virginia in no hurry right now. Remember all the tempo we saw in the first half? A big lead here, and they are taking their time here on this first drive to start the second half.
Yeah, very methodical in their approach because they've run the ball so well. Quarterback dropped his mouthpiece there.
It's Letty Brown. And he's crunched by Hollifield after a gain of 5. Now Letty Brown, the senior from Philadelphia. He will come out on this 3rd and 12. Now the ground game was slow to get going this season, but not today.
It's been exceptional. And you know what's so crazy about these numbers? Coach Brown says they want to let off a little bit, right? They didn't want to ride him too much, but he's played so well from the start. You kind of have to go with your joker.
So it's Mathis with the carry, and he's brought down by Pollard after a gain of four. So fourth down, West Virginia is in field goal range.
Talked to Coach Brown last night, and he thought that they would have Tony Mathis in the mix, right, getting a lot more reps coming back from injury, but, you know, it just hasn't worked out that way, right? You know, you got to go with the hot hand, and Letty Brown has had the hottest of hands and the hottest hand he's had all year.
This will be a 44-yard try for Casey Legg. That would match a season-long. Career-long is 51 from 44. Perfect. So Casey Legg has connected on two field goals, and West Virginia adds three to its lead. Number 48 from 44, West Virginia leads 27-7. Edward Jones, life is for living. Let's partner for all of it. Welcome back to Morgantown. West Virginia up by 20. A time-consuming drive for the Mountaineers to begin the second half. And Casey Legg adding three on a 44-yard field goal try. And no return for Blackshear as the Hokies will have it from the 25-yard line. Virginia Tech will have the ball, but West Virginia's defense was impressive, Devin, in the first half.
Talk about it at half. Killer bees flying around, and Burzmeier has had nowhere to go. They tackle well. You don't see a bunch of missed tackles, right? That's very important, right? Because you got guys on the Virginia Tech offense that can make you miss. West Virginia's defense has had none of that.
And Blackshear, he's shaken up on the play. Remember, Virginia Tech missing Keyshawn King today. He's out with a non-COVID-related illness. So Jalen Holston is the tailback right now for Burmeister. Pressure hit as he throws, and that's a near-diving catch. Incomplete, as that was intended for Jaden Paiute. Now, Burmeister, his legs, a vital part of his game, has only rushed for 24 yards.
The game of inches, the game we love so much, right? Just a bit outside, has an open guy. I love Burmeister's turns to stand in the pocket, right, with pressure coming to his outside and trying to get that ball out. Dante Steeles has been a tear on the edge.
Holston lost his footing, got it back at a strong run across the 30-yard line. Gain of six, tackled by Alonzo Adai. An important third and four right now for Virginia Tech.
It feels big, doesn't it, Corey?
Already nearly halfway through the quarter.
Before Burzmeier uses his legs.
Wide receiver screen. Not happening. West Virginia read that. Sean Mahone makes the play. It's a one-yard loss. So a three down for the Hokies as the punting unit is back out for Virginia Tech.
We saw a little in the first half that Virginia Tech trusted Burmeister to get the ball down the field, but they haven't gone back to it since early in the first, late in the first quarter. And West Virginia's defense is pinning their ears back and going back to, we're going to make sure we force you to throw the ball.
Just a 29-yard punt, so West Virginia making plays on defense. The offense is back on the field when we come back. Legendary Hall of Fame coaches have been a part of this rivalry over the years. The late Bobby Bowden, Don Nealon, and Frank Beamer. 12-7 all time against West Virginia. And now these two coaches getting their first taste of the Black Diamond Trophy rivalry today. Diggy fakes the handoff. Isaiah Estale with the reception.
Virginia Tech is going to have to find a way to get Diggy off of his spot. He is much too comfortable in the pocket right now. He comes off the play action, and he's just chilling. Just not a care in the world. Checks downfield, then checks it down smartly when he doesn't have it. they have to find a way to make them a little more uncomfortable.
So Virginia Tech defense, Devin, to your point, that produced 9 sacks the first two games. After a gain of 1, this is Letty Brown, slips away once and carries Hollyfield for an extra 3 or 4, eventually brought down by Adams.
That young man came to play today.
He certainly has. The 80-yard touchdown run, the second play from scrimmage for West Virginia today. Picked up 8 more. Clock running, under 6 minutes to play on the second drive for the Mountaineers in the second half. Hokies load the box defensively. It's Brown, first down, stiff-arming his way across the 45. Tackled by Connor. There is a flag.
Came from the back, just it could be holding.
Holding, offense number 87. 10-yard penalty.
It's on O'Loughlin.
Take a look to the right side of your screen. Right there. Getting across his face. They got the number wrong there. O'Loughlin's family's at home looking like, oh, that wasn't me. Get the camera off me. It's not me. Yep, everyone makes mistakes.
The 7th West Virginia penalty. On 3rd and 11. Brown. Ball comes out. Still loose, and then Brown jumped back on top of it. Jamari Connor popped it free. It was there for the taking for a brief moment, but it was Brown who pounced right on top of it.
They get the ball to Brown quickly, as we suspected, and he has nowhere really to go, and then boom! Whew, the ball pops out quickly. Luckily, Lady Brown's able to get right back on it to save some field position, right? The most important thing, they're going to punt the ball away, but field position is saved so that Virginia Tech will have to drive the entire field rather than have it in West Virginia territory.
It's a good hit by Connor, co-captain. Robinson, not much on the return. A 39-yard punt, 3-yard return. Virginia Tech will have the ball when we come back. Recover from this terrible disaster. Vital drive here for the Hokies, down 20. Burmeister pressured, and down he goes. There is a flag. Jared Bartlett, the redshirt sophomore from Miami, got home, and a sack for the Mountaineers.
It's going to be a holding right here. He did everything he could to stop this young man, but there was no stopping him.
It's on 69, Luke Tenuta, who moved from right to left tackle with Christian Darrisaw. Drafted first round by the Vikings, and Bartlett beat him.
It's the quarterback's worst nightmare, right? Edge blitz, right? You see it all the way. But that smaller, quicker linebacker, the offensive tackle is just not able to get his hands on him. 6'2", 225 pounds. Speed off the edge.
After a loss of 9, here's Caleb Smith. And he'll be shouldered out near the original line of scrimmage by Chandler Cimito. It's a long third down upcoming here for Virginia Tech.
We haven't called Smith's name a bunch today. Looks like West Virginia had a corner blitz at top of your screen. Let's see if they take it off. You know, it's a chess match. You see the offense look to the sideline, then they change the defense. They're not going to come anymore.
Mountaineers bring three. Burmeister steps up, throws high. That's caught by Blackshear, and he'll have a first down as he brought it back inside and stretches near the 35 as he is slow to get up.
Detroit.
Now the Hokies thin in the backfield today. No King. Blackshear's been in and out. And hopefully he can walk that off. So we have a timeout. Virginia Tech and Blackshear pick up the first down. They'll keep it when we come back.
His catch to get the first down. Young pass catches at home. Hands, right? The reason he's able to get vertical very quickly is because he catches it with his hands, puts the ball away, and gets the first down. That's a big first down for Virginia Tech as they try to move back into this game.
Jalen Holst in the tailback to Burmeister's left. Under three to play in the third. And a flag blows this one dead.
These tackles are trying to get out of there, right? Like we talked about, that defense has their ears pinned back, and when it's a pass play, they are trying to get after the passer. That's when you start getting the false starts from the tackles, trying to get in their pass sets with those smaller rushers coming after them.
Blackshear stays out. Now six penalties for Virginia Tech today. Four false start penalties. Burmeister throws open down the sideline. Drake Dooley is the tight end. Got open, and Burmeister hit him for a big play.
What a throw. They put Dubious in motion and then sent him up the rail, and the West Virginia defense gets caught looking in the backfield off the play action. Very good job. Well-designed play and a very good throw.
Low snap. And Burmeister jumps on top of it. And after a 39-yard play, the Hokies lose a few.
Looks like he didn't even know it was coming, and it's at his feet. Unforced errors. Virginia Tech is not in a position to have things like this happen during the game at this point. They're down 20. They have to move the ball, and they cannot waste downs. Second and long now, and it's you got to look for a screen here, something to try to get some of these yards back. And it looks like West Virginia is bringing everybody.
The second Mountaineer sack today.
You can see at the onset, West Virginia's defensive line is not getting through, right? You get a pulling guard, and then he just burst out of a cannon right through the quarterback. Very good job fighting to continue to still get to the quarterback. Long developing plays take some time, so you have time to get to the quarterback, and Taj Austin does a great job there.
Injured West Virginia player halts play with a minute 17 to go in the third quarter. I'll keep it right here on FS1 because coming up next, Chris Olave and number 9 Ohio State looks to get back on track following last week's loss to Oregon as they host the Golden Hurricane from Tulsa. College football action rolls on next on FS1.
Corey, have you seen Olave play this year? I mean, it's almost unfair. He should not be allowed to still be in college. I mean, as smooth as can be, catches everything. Looks like he's playing in slow motion. Everybody else is in slow motion. He's faster than everyone. It's just not fair.
Olave and Purdue, David Bell, elite wide receivers in the Big Ten. But Olave is so talented. Buckeyes and Golden Hurricane coming up later here on FS1. And Sean Mahone, second leading tackler on this Mountaineer defense. He was shaken up. He walks off on his own.
Always good to see a guy walk off on his own power. As you can see, an efficient day for Burmeister, but third and 24.
But this is four down territory, isn't it?
Absolutely. Quarter, but there just aren't a lot of plays in your playbook for third and 24. I can tell you that. The goal here, try to get half, right? Try to get half of his back so you got him favorable fourth down.
Burmeister makes a great cut to the outside. Another good move, and Burmeister with a big time effort. first down on 3rd and 24, picked up nearly 25.
Burmeister says, I see your half, and I raise you all of it. I mean, he has guys on skates, and that's the danger of that type of quarterback on 3rd and 24. What play do you have? Everybody run deep, and I'll go get it myself. Nice play by Burmeister. You can see the fight is still in him for sure.
By far his most important run today. 1st and 10. Blackshear back in. He goes nowhere. Jackie Matthews made the play. Redshirt junior from Birmingham. No gain.
The reason West Virginia has been so dominant in stopping the run today, they add extras, right? Maybe an extra blitzer from the field. Maybe a blitzer from the boundary. They always add an extra guy to make sure that they put pressure on this run game.
Hokies have rushed for only 65 yards. Final play of the third quarter. Good run here for Blackshear to the outside, towards the end zone. And Blackshear is in. Touchdown, Virginia Tech. A 20-yard touchdown run for Raheem Blackshear. And with 1 second to go in the third, the Hokies have their second score today.
He had a big catch to pick up a first down early in this drive, and he can run. He gets to the outside. West Virginia brought extra, but they brought it to the field, which left the backside wide open for the runner, Blackshear.
Got a key block from the right guard, Caden Moore. And the extra point is up and good for John Parker Romo. So it was a 3rd down and 24, remember. And Devin, we were thinking maybe the Hokies try to get half. Burmeister said forget that.
He had other ideas. And this young man, I mean, I just can't help but think, even with the number 3 on Taylor Martinez, and then Blackshear gets the ball in the outside zone, follows his blockers, and races Young to the end zone.
His 3rd rushing touchdown this season, 11th career, the transfer from Rutgers in his second year at Virginia Tech. And the Hokies.
You can see after that touchdown, he's like, hey, no celebration. We don't need to celebrate. We still have a long way to go. This is just one brick on this wall that we're trying to build on a comeback.
Virginia Tech 2-0 to start the year, ranked 15th in the country. West Virginia leads by 13. And now Romo will kick it away to the dangerous Winston Wright Jr. And no chance here, as the Mountaineers will have the ball from their own 25-yard line. That rushing score for Blackshear was the first rushing score that West Virginia's defense has allowed all season long.
And you can see why, right? Like I talked about, they add extras in the run game, and it allows them to play freely in the back end. And then the safeties are also low, right? They get into that cover 4 defense that they like to play. They bring their safeties low, and they can help in the run game. But there, they brought pressure to the wrong side.
It's 1 second to go in the third. And here's Brown, the final play of the quarter. And a good run there for Letty Brown. He has had one heck of a day today. That's the end of the third quarter. We go to the 4th in Morgantown, West Virginia by 13 on FS1. In Morgantown, West Virginia 27, 15th ranked Virginia Tech 14. As the Mountaineers have the ball as we start the final quarter in the 53rd meeting between the Mountaineers and the Hokies. Tony Mathis Jr., the tailback, on 2nd down and 2. It is Mathis, and he is popped right near the line of scrimmage. Nasir Peoples, the Virginia Tech leading tackler. And 11 tackles alone against Middle Tennessee State last week. And now Letty Brown is back in. Gain of one of the play. Looked like Brown was cramping in between quarters. He is good to go on this third and one.
Can't imagine someone else other than Letty Brown. Let's see the quarterback sneak. With help from Letty Brown on the push. He does it all, Corey. I mean, what can he not do?
As Daigie's helmet came off.
All right, looks like Daigie's going to be a little bit stuffed at the start. And then here goes Letty Brown driving those legs. And it made his own quarterback's helmet come off there. Yeah, Daigie has to come out for a play. Helmet comes off, but they feel very comfortable with Green in the game. It's probably going to be some type of read option and try and get him running on the edge.
Green had two carries for 16 yards in the first half. One pass. It'll be a run up the middle for Green. And he finds space up the middle for a gain of seven. So Green comes out. Daigie back in.
What a luxury, right, to have Green, someone you can trust, right, and not bat an eye, right, stay within your offense and just get him on a quarterback run just when your quarterback has to come out for a play. I mean, that's the luxury that a lot of teams around the FBS do not have.
And West Virginia got the ball first to begin the second half. It was a very time-consuming drive. Ended up with a field goal from Casey Legg. Keep it on the ground. Here's Brown. Spinning, still knocked down, and now they blow it dead. That effort, though, draws a bit.
The operative word there is effort. A guy that's already had quite a day. I mean, this is a very nice run, right? He should be stopped right there. Absolutely not. I'm going to continue to drag this young man, pull my foot out, and then, hey, you guys help me. Pull me forward.
Approaching 200 yards of offense today.
Oh, man. And they wanted to let up, right? We talked last night. He said, hey, we want to try to take some off. But he has played so well.
Here he is again. It's up about one. Jordan Williams made the stop. Yeah, Neil Brown talked about that too, saying not just today, but moving forward. Hey, conference play is right around the corner for West Virginia. So Letty Brown has done all this work today, but can he maintain this pace as you work your way into conference play?
Yeah, that's very important. And I think that they're going to keep continuing to find ways as Tony Mathis gets more comfortable, find ways to spell Letty Brown and give other people opportunities so that Letty Brown can be fresh throughout the entire season.
That's a catch. That's Reese Smith. Redshirt freshman from Danville, Kentucky, makes his first reception this season. Caught 11 passes last year, picks up five. It's now eight different Mountaineers that have caught a pass today.
Yeah, he's really spreading it around. I mean, at one point in the game, I had it written down. He was six completions to five different receivers and two touchdowns, and he's improved on that as the day's gone on.
Brown picks up pressure from behind. Ball is out, and the Hokies pick it up. That's Tisdale. Virginia Tech needed to make a play on defense. The Hokies do just that. Taiwan Garbett popped it free. Tisdale picked it up, and the Hokies make a huge play in this fourth quarter.
It's always the guy you don't see with one hand on the ball. Just for an inkling of a second, the ball pops out. Very good job by that Virginia Tech defense playing opportunistic, getting the ball out, and giving their team a chance.
It's the first turnover for either team today. And the second fumble that the Hokies have recovered all season long. And here comes Burmeister.
You know what I like? I like shots on sudden change of possession. They're going to a shot here.
That's caught near the 42-yard line by Caleb Smith.
Not a huge shot, right? They're putting the ball in the air. Something uncharacteristic, something they haven't done a whole bunch.
Third catch for Smith. There's Blackshear. And he stood up near the line to gain. Mahone and Scotty Young Jr. stood up Blackshear, gain of six and a first down for Virginia Tech.
It's a very good job by Scotty Young at the point of attack, right? Being stout as the receiver tries to block him.
Blackshear slipped and never recovered. Akeem Mezzador and Sean Martin combined for a loss of one.
Corey, it's been very surprising to me. You haven't seen Burmeister in that situation pull the ball. It looks like he's had a few opportunities where he could have pulled the ball and got a few yards, and he just hasn't done it today. And we know he's healthy, right? We know. We see him in the passing game, right, taking off and running. So I wonder, are they calling plays where they take the read off just so they can protect him because they know he's going to run in the passing game?
Pressure coming on second down, in trouble, and down he goes. Burmeister sacked. Jared Bartlett again, his second sack today.
He has become very dangerous in the pass rush game today. Here he's coming from the field. He's just going to beat the running back. If a tackle can't block him, you know a running back has no chance. He gives him a little in and out, jumps on the quarterback's back, and has him down to the ground in a jiffy.
Now Bartlett, two sacks today at 3.5 sacks in 10 games last year.
Do they bring him again? Here he is, lined up at the line of scrimmage.
Here he comes on 3rd and 17. Burmeister throws. That's caught. Well shot the first down by Smith near the 31.
The play call intentional, that you know you're going to go for it on 4th down, right? Get some of it back and be prepared to convert on 4th down.
It's a gain of 13, so 4th and 6th for Virginia Tech. 0-1 on 4th down tries in this one today. It is loud in Morgantown. Near the 25, that's Smith again. A gain of 8, first down Virginia Tech. As Burmeister has found a good target here in Caleb Smith.
Nice timing, Burmeister. 1-2-3 hitch and drive a stop route right on the outside shoulder of the receiver. Very good job of timing. When you run a stop route, it's almost impossible to stop from off coverage because of the timing of the quarterback and the receiver.
Under 8 to play. Virginia Tech on the move, down 13. It's a run up the middle. This is Holston inside the 10. He's shouldered out by Matthews. First and goal, Virginia Tech.
Outside zone, and all of the West Virginia defenders get caught inside. He sticks his foot in the ground. Very good job by the offensive lineman cutting across and getting to the second level, allowing the running back to get outside.
17-yard gain, Burmeister. Incomplete. Pressure coming from Matthews as he hit the turf. Meister, 165 yards passing. With the pressure West Virginia has provided today, he's only rushed for 20 yards. Ninth play of the drive upcoming. On second and goal, it's Holston to the 5. There's Bartlett again. What a second half he is having.
There again, Burmeister had an opportunity with a lead blocker to pull the ball and take it around the edge, but he just decides not to. And you can see he's lifting up his shoulder, right? Playing with his arm a little bit. Maybe it's a little sore there, and he doesn't want to add on hits from the defense in the running game.
Had a shoulder injury early in his career as a Duck, and he got banged up last week, left the ball game early in the first half against Middle Tennessee State, but still came back. Play clock at 2 on 3rd and goal. Trey Turner dropped by Jackie Matthews. Fourth down.
They just don't have enough, right? You're running into unblocked defenders, and when you run into unblocked defenders at the Power 5 level, this is what's going to happen every single time. The corner steps up, Jackie Matthews, and just lowers a hit, but nobody even had an opportunity to block him.
Makes sense. The Hokies down 13, two-score game. A field goal doesn't change that. On fourth and goal, ball comes out. Burmeister hit, picked up by West Virginia's Bartlett. Mountaineers ball.
He is having himself quite a day. On the offensive side, you have Letty Brown. And on the defensive side, Jared Bartlett.
And Dixon. Ball came out. West Virginia ball under six to play. For living, let's partner for all of it. Jared Bartlett, what an impact he has made in this second half. The redshirt sophomore from Collins Hill High School in Sewanee, Georgia, making play after play. Mountaineers ball under six to play. Leading by 13. Letty Brown with the carry.
Here, West Virginia is just going to try to salt the clock away. Got an injured player on the field.
Injured Hokie, and we'll step aside here in the fourth quarter. Injured Hokie. Sipping some Gatorade as he comes out.
Sure, it's filled with electrolytes.
And Virginia Tech did have to burn its first time out. From the 9-yard line, Daigie steps up, and he's dropped near the 10 by Hollifield. Picked up a yard. Time stops with 5:44 to go. And the Hokies take their second timeout.
Could all but guarantee the conversation on the sideline to Daigie was, hey, we're going to call a pass play here, but if it's not a completion and you know it for sure, do not throw the ball, right? Tuck the ball, try to get what you can so we can keep this clock rolling. Or force Virginia Tech to take timeouts.
So the offense on the field right now, but the West Virginia defense has been impressive, and in the second half, especially number 10.
Three sacks and a strip sack on the previous drive for Jared Bartlett. I mean, he has been special, and this is the type of Khalil Mack type game that he's having where, hey, we can't block him. So when they get back on offense, Virginia Tech, if they're allowed to, they have to find a way to double and stop him, because your passing game is going to be obsolete if he continues to get that type of pressure.
Career high three sacks for Bartlett today. On third and nine. And Letty Brown has stood up. And Virginia Tech will not use its last time out here. Clock running under 5:30 to play. After a 4-yard gain, Brown kind of favoring that left shoulder, left arm a little bit as he tries to shake it out on the Mountaineer sideline.
Yeah, that's a universal sign for stinger. All right, you get hit and it's a little sore. You got to shake it out. Just try to get it out. He'll be fine.
Tyler Sumter has had himself quite the day punting. From his own goal line.
There he is again. What a punt.
Oh, a nice job there from Robinson to pick it up. It was dangerous, but still would have given up a ton of field. So Virginia Tech will have the ball in Mountaineer territory when we come back. Sponsored by Lincoln and the power of Sanctuary. This drive by West Virginia in the second quarter. Six plays, 56 yards, and it ended with the Daigie to Sam James touchdown play to make it 21-7.
Yeah, it was sparked by Green coming in and getting some ground attack from the quarterback position and then transition into Daigie through the air. And here is Burmeister through the air.
Incomplete. Intended for Trey Turner. Haven't called his name much today. Coverage provided by Nick Troy Fortune. Well, Burmeister, now is his time for the Hokies' drive of the game.
Yeah, it's going to have to be that, right? You're going to have to get a drive here, get a stop on defense for you to have a chance in this game. At least the only positive with that incompletion, the clock stopping, they can get a good play call.
Ohio State, Tulsa coming up next. On second and 10, Burmeister throws. That's caught near the 35-yard line by Turner. Clock will stop temporarily as they reset the lines.
For people just tuning in, I just want you to know, Burmeister has not played a bad game, right? He's been in control. His stats aren't gaudy, but he has done what he needs to do. Just hasn't been able to convert in bigger situations.
Hangs in there, fires down the side. Had a man open, could not connect to Blackshear.
Got the one turnover on the fumble, which was fourth down anyway, right? Wasn't right. Entirely his fault, right? In the pocket. And that terror on the outside, Jared Bartlett comes and gets the ball out. But from excluding that, he's played very well, under control, protected the ball, made the right decisions. He even has a fourth and 24 where he picks up a big first down with his legs. His legs are going to have to be important here because it looks like West Virginia is sitting back waiting for the pass.
On second down, throws low near the 20-yard line. That's a clean catch for Caleb Smith. That's his fifth reception today. Picks up 13. He had three catches all year before today.
West Virginia's playing a type of umbrella defense where they're allowing everything to be caught in front of them because they know that the clock is going to continue to run with these complete passes. With Virginia Tech only having one timeout, they cannot stop the clock, right? So they're going to let them catch it, and tackle and rally to the ball.
Dangerous pass and nearly intercepted by Daryl Porter Jr. Intended for Smith. The number two in goal had a shot.
The closer you get to the end zone, the more difficult it becomes for the quarterback. Because now those West Virginia defenders, everything in front of them is in front of the goal line. And they're going to be pinning their ears back and driving on the ball because they know that you can't get ran past.
And here comes Bartlett. Burmeister goes down. Bartlett was first, and then it was Taj Alston with Jordan Jefferson.
Taj Alston and Jordan Jefferson going to split that sack, but we at home all know where that sack came from, and it's Bartlett again going for his fourth. I mean, he can't be blocked. You have to dedicate another guy. You have to dedicate another guy because he is tearing your passing game to pieces. Braxton Burmeister under pressure a ton today and sacked six times.
Five in the second half on third and 18, trying to find something underneath. It's Holston. Holston cuts back inside the 10. Touchdown, Hokies. Virginia Tech still alive in the fourth quarter.
We just talked about Burmeister being sacked six times. For him to have the poise to stand in the pocket and look and climb and wait and then throw to his check down, and his check down does the rest. Holston gets in the end zone and keeps Virginia Tech in this game.
And the extra point is good. 6-point game with 3:10 to play. Hokies have one timeout left. Burmeister needed a big drive. He got it done to Holston. 6-point game in Morgantown. 24-7 at halftime, but on third and 17, Burmeister found Holston for 29 yards. A 6-point game.
Just over three to play in the fourth. Onside kick time right now. One timeout for the Hokies. Devin?
Yeah, I think it is, right? With a 40-second play clock, you'll be down to not much time. But it looks like they're going to kick it deep unless they're trying to trick us and the West Virginia return team. You're not going to have a lot of time if you do get a three and out and get the ball back.
And they do send it away. And out of the end zone. So they do kick it deep. One timeout, 3:10 to play. Next weekend on Fox, starts Saturday strong with a big noon kickoff pregame show at 10 a.m. Eastern, live from Soldier Field in Chicago. Then at noon Eastern, we have a good one for you. Jack Cohn and number 12 Notre Dame take on 18th ranked Wisconsin. A huge big noon Saturday begins at 10 a.m. Eastern, 7 Pacific on Fox and the Fox Sports app. Jack Cohn, the Wisconsin transfer. Now with the Irish. Should be great next week.
Without taking that onside kick, Virginia Tech is looking at 103 or below when they get the ball back.
There's Brown, and he's dropped to the line of scrimmage by Allen Tisdale, and Virginia Tech will take its final timeout with 3:06 to go in the game. Now the Hokies are back in this game. Some huge second half plays. It was 3rd and 23. Burmeister kept it himself. Picked up 25 in the first down. Then on the ground to Blackshear. And then the turnover. Picked up by Tisdale. And then Burmeister. In the pocket. Hung tough. Found Holston. 29 yards out. And we have a six-point game with 3:06 to go. Justin Fuente and the Hokies have no timeouts left. 27-21 Mountaineers.
At home, remember, just before half, right with a chance inside the five to score, they get a penalty, push them back, and then they have to try a field goal and miss the field goal. That field goal looms very important because now, instead of going to get three to tie, you have to score a touchdown, which will allow you to win the game if you're Virginia Tech.
Garrett Green back in at quarterback on second down. It's Green with a run and lost his footing across the 30. Cut back on Holyfield after a gain of 5. Is Green going to stay in on 3rd and 5? It looks like he will. So the run options here, Green keeps it himself, or number 4 has been pretty good.
He's been decent, you know, Corey. Number 4 has been decent. Yeah. Take a timeout and discuss. All right, because you need a big play, right? If you get a first down here, this game is over. So they're going to take a timeout, figure out exactly what they want, and try to execute.
So West Virginia calls its first timeout. Neil Brown, in his third season coaching at West Virginia, defeating ranked teams has not been easy. Only one win over a ranked team, and that was last year, defeated Kansas State.
This next play will decide if he for sure puts a 2 where that 1 is, or if it's left a chance and Burmeister gets another opportunity. Now, Corey, is there any chance, right? You know, can you trust your question? Is there any chance you call a pass play here and sneak a tight end out in the flat or something like that?
Well, remember, in terms of play calling, it's a shared responsibility between Neil Brown and offensive coordinator Jared Parker. But at the end of the day, the head coach makes the call.
After talking to Jared Parker yesterday, I'm just telling you, he wants to throw this football into the flat and try to get hands on it. And I'm just telling you right now, Neil Brown says, absolutely not. We will not be doing that. We'll be running the ball.
So here comes Garrett Green back out. On 3rd and 5.
Just some window dressing to give a different look and get the defense off balance. They got a false start by the right guard. False start.
Wow.
The smallest of flinches. The smallest of flinches.
False start. Offense. Number 74. 5-yard penalty. Third down.
James Gmitter, the left guard. The eighth West Virginia penalty is a whopper.
Corey, when I tell you the smallest of flinches. Goodness. Oh, my goodness. It's actually number 52 on the right. Parker Moore.
Daigie back in now on third and 10, setting up the screen. Throws. It's intercepted. Jermaine Waller with the pick. His third of the season. Daigie makes a mistake in traffic.
The beginning of this game, we said, can he come in and look for the trifecta? He gets it here. When you're throwing a screen pass, the ball has to be low. If your guy gets it or nobody gets it, Waller is sitting and waiting and makes a play when his team desperately needs it to stay in this game, and now they look to win it.
For nearly 57 minutes, Jared Daigie made all the right decisions, but not there. On first and 10, Blackshear up the middle, stretches out near the 12. Hokies have no timeouts left.
Football is a game of momentum, and Mr. Momentum has changed his address. It resides on the Virginia Tech sideline.
And Blackshear is down again. And he is up on his feet.
Yeah, he suffered from cramping, you know, it seems like this entire second half.
Blackshear will head towards the sideline.
Man, those cramps are a doozy. I've had cramp issues before in my life, and when I tell you, it shuts everything down and it makes you walk just like that.
Holston back in. On second and four. Turner in motion. Holston to the five. Down to the three. And now does West Virginia think about calling a timeout here?
That's an interesting question here.
One timeout left here.
You have one timeout left, and you want to leave some time for you to get down the field. But because Virginia Tech is so close to the goal line, I don't see West Virginia using that timeout. So if they do score, they can use it in their drive.
Clock running. First and goal.
Burmeister's legs. They've been huge all day. We saw it on third and 24. Let's see if we'll see it again inside the five to win the game.
The snap. It's Holston up the middle. No gain. Mezador. And Chandler Cimito on the stop. West Virginia does call its final timeout. There have been some memorable moments over the years between these two rivals. Let's go back to 1999. Freshman sensation, that guy Michael Vick, led number three Virginia Tech in a last-minute drive, highlighted by this 36-yard run. And then Shane Graham, number 17, banged it through. And the Hokies at the time kept their national championship hopes alive with a two-point win on second and goal. Stuffed. Third down.
Another opportunity for Burmeister to pull the ball out and run the ball in the end zone, or almost walk the ball in the end zone. He's had those opportunities all day. two downs to get in that end zone. I cannot see a scenario where he does not try to use his legs to get in the end zone.
Let's correct it. West Virginia took its final timeout now, did not on the previous snap. So this potentially could add to the memorable moments in this rivalry, and it's possible because of this Jarrett Daigie interception by Jermaine Waller.
We talked earlier about the competitive fire of Daigie, right? Always wanting to make a play. When there's no play there, he's gotten himself in trouble. We saw it in week one against Maryland, trying to make something happen. Not because he's not a smart player, because he wants to win. And sometimes that gets you in trouble, and he finds himself in trouble right now inside the five with Virginia Tech knocking on the door.
Rolling, spinning, throwing, end zone! Incomplete! Intended for Turner. Comes down to this. No timeouts. Fourth and goal.
If I'm a West Virginia fan or player on the sideline, my heart is pounding. This young man running around is terrifying, and they have one shot to win this game right here.
On fourth and goal, Burmeister rolling, throwing back, and it's incomplete. Knocked away. Turner wanted a flag. West Virginia makes a play. Jackie Matthews with the coverage, and West Virginia leading by six.
The ball goes over on downs. After the play was over, unsportsmanlike conduct number 12 on West Virginia. The penalty is half the distance to the goal line. West Virginia ball, first down.
Meister tries to extend the play as long as he can. We've seen him do it all day, and he just has to get rid of it. West Virginia defense holds with the game on the line.
Akeem Mezidor and the West Virginia defense with the game on the line had to make a stop.
The quarterback sneak here ends it.
And Daigie does just that. Dante Stills and the West Virginia Mountaineers, for the first time since 2003, beat Virginia Tech. The Black Diamond Trophy has been in Blacksburg for over 6,000 days. It was brought to Morgantown. It's staying in Morgantown. West Virginia knocks off number 15 Virginia Tech in the 53rd meeting. Great to have this rivalry back. It moves to Blacksburg next season. For Devin Garter and our great crew, Corey Probus saying so long. We now send it to Los Angeles. Once again, here's Mike Hill.
All right, what a game there, guys. Meanwhile, Ohio.